Well, hello everyone. It's been a wee while. I do apologize, but I'm sure you've seen the stuff on my channel as to why. Hope that's acceptable. But this is going to be a quick video. I'm aiming for around the half-hour mark. I've got an appointment just after then, so I'm time constrained. So this will just be a nice little short one, hopefully get me back in the swing of making the videos and reassure you guys that this is something I'm going to continue with, particularly because of all the fantastic comments people have given me on the YouTube. And it really has given me the inspiration to pick this back up again and get it going. So let me just go full screen. So based on some of the comments, couple of you were saying that you didn't like the fact that I was so zoomed in on the code. I made it just look a little bit rubbish if you're viewing this on a computer, which it seems a lot of you are. My test sample was I watch most of my YouTube on my TV using a Chromecast, so I'm sat naturally quite far away, but this is driven by you guys, so hopefully this looks better. Please feedback. Happy to fine tune it, zoom in a little bit more, zoom out a little bit more, font sizes and so on, and I'll keep tweaking it until you guys are happy with it. So this is where we left off, looking at the Wi-Fi stuff. Very, very early days in this Wi-Fi class definition, and the first thing we were looking at that we need that is useful that the Wi-Fi class will provide is our MAC address. Very useful. Just as a recap, it's a unique address. Each ESP has a unique, each silicon has a unique MAC address, and that's guaranteed by Espressif, if I believe. So it serves as a very, very useful bit of data to have that we can then use wherever to differentiate this particular ESP from all the others we've got running in our house or, you know, on the Internet of Things or whatever you want to do. The question I left you with all those months ago was, we've got this method here, get MAC, where we call the API to get the MAC address from the silicon, print that out as a C string of hex, so just a bunch of hex here, and that's our buffer, and we save that as a static char or C string effectively here, which can then be read by any inherited class and so on. Any child class, should I say, or anything else via the get MAC, and this is just returning a char star pointer. We'll talk a little bit more about the correctness of that and whether this could be better. Got a few thoughts around that. There is certainly nothing wrong with this, so if this is what you've done, then you're golden. This is fairly typical of the way you would do it. So there's nothing wrong, but I want to give you as many different thoughts and ideas, pros and cons, as I've got in my arsenal, and then you can make your own informed decision. But the question I left you with is, each time we need to get this MAC address, so we need to populate this buffer with some data. We don't want to do it on every single call to get MAC address. We just want to return the pointer because it's never going to change throughout the lifetime of the code. And when I say lifetime of the code, I mean whilst it is powered up and the RAM is there storing this data. Obviously it will not persist beyond reboots, which is why we do the API call here to get it from the effectively the non-volatile, although it's that's not strictly where it is, but it is non-volatile memory. I think it's held in the fuses, but I don't know. So we only want to run this code once, and that seems like quite a trivial thing. This call, this whole function is only going to use a few clock cycles. Does it really matter? No, in this situation, of course, it doesn't. But if we are running this in a loop over and over again, you know, those cycles add up. And what's more important is getting you thinking about, all right, this particular function, maybe it doesn't make that much of a difference. But if you understand how we could make this run only once, then you can apply that to something maybe less trivial and more critical. Sorry about the pinging in the background. That's my Google Hangouts going nuts. So we had a couple of thoughts and a couple of ways we can do this to ensure this function, this method, is run only once. We can basically do it in the constructor, so get Mac. But the problem with this is each time, if we have a child class, for example, or multiple instances of Wi-Fi, which on the face of it sounds a bit odd, but later down the line in this project, you will understand why there may be multiple instances of this object and why that is quite useful, actually, in object-oriented stuff. I've already got an implementation of this running on some projects, and they use multiple objects of Wi-Fi, and it becomes very, very convenient to do that. Quite object-oriented, but that's the way we can do it. So we could have, for example, this is just checking that getting the MAC address worked, otherwise we'll call abort. Actually, on the ESP, there's a better way of doing this. Restart. Oh my gosh, I can't type. Start. ESP restart. Also calls abort, ultimately, but it will also call any shutdown handler that we have assigned, any code, and it also sets a flag, a non-volatile flag in the CPU to say the reason the CPU restarted was because we called this function. Just makes it a bit easier for debugging. We'll go into the usefulness of that later down the line when we're outside of Wi-Fi and doing more system-wide stuff. So a very simple way of doing this would be to just assign this to a static variable. So what we could do, so if I leave that code there, have a static in here, ESPL, let's just call it val for short, is equal to get Mac. And effectively what this does is, because it's static, has static lifetime, this line will only get called once on the very first instantiation of this. What's the downside to doing this? Well, what's the downside to any static? Jason Turner has done a cracking video. I think he's done a couple, actually. He does the C++ Weekly stuff on YouTube. Awesome, awesome stuff. And he discusses the problems, don't know why I rolled my R there, with static, and what actually happens in the disassembly of this. So first of all, the CPU has to check to see whether or not this has been called before. And it has to get a lock, and it has to check, and then if not, so there's a branch, it will call the method. If true, then it skips. So it's not simply call this method and assign it to this variable. It has to do some locking because statics are inherently safe, and it has to do a little bit of checking to see whether or not it's the first call or not. So whether this object, in terms of this, it's rather than an object, it's just a value, has been initialized. So actually a lot goes under the hood, so that's quite chunky. But in the grand scheme of things, that may be perfectly acceptable. Equally, you could have a do it a little bit more complex. Oh, hello, my VS Code has just crapped itself. Hello, there we go. You could do this maybe a slightly more verbose way. So we could have a bool called first call, for example. Let's get into a naming habit here, is false. So this will initialize to false. And if not, sorry, been doing Python recently. if not first call, then we can call get Mac. And we also need to change this flag. So let's stick that in brackets. And first call equals true. That effectively does exactly the same thing as the code we just wrote before. A little bit more verbose, a little bit more useful to look at. In this case, we could actually implement our original mechanism. So if that fails, we will do a restart. If it doesn't, all things carry on good. This static, it has static lifetime. So the second time this constructor is called, first call will now be true. So we'll just skip this branch altogether. So there is a branch, there is a compare. A little bit more verbose, but we get a little bit more functionality doing it this way, which might be nice and might be what we want. There is also a standard template library implementation of this as well. I'm going to pull up Stack Overflow. This is linked in Jose Barr's comment on the third video. So you can find the link and find this there. If I just zoom it in. There is, so this sort of shows a couple of implementations for this, what we could do, but there is a standard template library call once routine or thing that you can do, which does a similar as you would expect. So that is an option as well. However, I'm going to do it a slightly different way. Again, may not be the best way, but it is a way. And this is largely based around a little gotcha I had fairly recently. When the ESP boots, typically in your routines and everything, you start initializing everything. You're creating all your objects and getting everything built. And that happens rather fast. Equally important to note is that we've got two cores. We have two cores and we have multiple threads. Now, multiple threads isn't necessarily an issue with statics. Multiple cores can be. That's a very, very loose throwaway statement. The issue I came across was actually related to optimization. And what was happening was the code had been optimized in such a way that two different threads creating two different Wi-Fi objects had both seen or been optimized to see that on the very first call, this variable is false, and therefore we're going to run this bit of code here. But because the optimizer had already made that decision that the value was going to be false on the first call, two different objects ended up running this chunk of code, and they shouldn't have. Now, in this instance, that's actually not going to cause you a huge amount of issues. It's a bug, but it's actually not going to cause us a problem in this case. We're fairly lucky. But again, we want to be thinking about doing this properly, and I'm imagining you guys taking this sort of structure or this architecture and using it on something where this actually may cause a big problem. And in my implementation where I noticed it was causing an issue. It wasn't this simple, just getting the MAC address. Ironically, it was doing that, but it was doing a bunch of other things at the same time. And we ended up calling API initialization methods, functions, repeatedly, and it was getting us into a weird state that wasn't hugely deterministic. And that was caused by multi-threads on multi-cores. So the very standard way that's been around since the year dot for doing this is to use what we call atomic variables. So we will include atomic, if I can smell, and we are going to have an atomic variable, which will have to be static, and we can use one of the type aliases, because this is just going to be a bool. And we'll call it first call. Standard atomic bool first call. Yeah, that's correct. Now, because this is static, that's our definition. Declaration. So now we actually do the definition. And let's do that down here. And we will set this to false. Don't spell. Yeah, there we go. All hunky-dory here. And now we don't need this weird static declaration in here. And we've got our first call, which is initialized to false when the program starts. And then it's going to set it to true. So what's the difference here? Why is standard by using an atomic variable, or what even is an atomic variable? So simply put, an atomic variable is guaranteed to not cause a race condition. What we mean by that is it cannot be read whilst it is being written. So effectively, all it is in this implementation is a boolean value that is protected by a mutex. A mutex means that you have to obtain a lock in order to be able to read or write this variable. And then once you've read or written that variable, then you release the lock. Only one instance of that lock exists, so regardless of whether it's on another CPU, another thread, whatever, doesn't matter. Only one thing can access this at once. It's actually a little bit deeper than that. Multiple things can read this at once. The way that atomic is implemented, because reading doesn't actually change the state in this case for a boolean, but if someone tries to write, then all reads will be blocked until the write has been completed. So that means that two threads can't run this at the same time and cause an issue. And because there's this write here, I believe that the compiler will see this and go, ah, I see what you're trying to do there, I'm clever, and we'll make sure that we have a sensible calling of this, I believe. Please do correct me if I'm wrong, but this has always solve the issue for me. So again, may not be the best implementation. We're using the standard template library, which some people may not be happy with. For in this case, I'm perfectly happy with that. And is C portable as well. So I think the C version of this is that. Oops. I think off the top of my head, but the C++ version is just atomic there. Always good to see if this builds, and we'll see if we've got any issues. You might notice it might pop up in here. I've upgraded to IDF 4.2, and incidentally, I have now pushed this code up to GitHub. I've not tidied up the GitHub and started my Git flow and done all that, but this code, as you see it on this screen, is up on GitHub. The changes I'm making in this video will get pushed up probably before this video goes live. There is a link in one of the comments on video 3, but going forwards I'll put a link to the GitHub in the description of the video, so it should be in the description of this video you're watching now. That's compiled fine, so Everything looks hunky-dory from a compiling point of view and linking point of view. So I'm happy that this is only going to get called once right at the start. We could do this with a mutex. Shall I show you that way of doing it? Yes, why the devil not, actually. So let me just pull up some notes. So let's do this the mutex way of doing it. And to be honest, actually, this is my preferred way of doing it. We'll use the standard template libraries mutex. I normally use the FreeRTOS one. If I've got time, we'll do that as well. So this is going to be a standard mutex. Stands for mutually exclusive or mutual exclusion. So it means only one thing can do the thing at once. And we will have a first call mutex. And then we'll get that into our initialization mutex like that. We don't need the false here. And dee be dee be dee be dee. Yeah. That's fine. Yeah, that's correct. I'm happy with that. So now we do something slightly different. We need something to protect. So we still need this first call variable. So I shouldn't have deleted that. So let's just stick that in. Bool, and it's the Wi-Fi class, and it's first call. We'll initialize that to false. We use brace initialization. That's what I prefer. In this instance, there is no difference to doing that. In other instances, that actually may cause a difference. Realistically, it gets optimized out. It calls to the copy constructor. But anyway, we'll do brace initialization because it's what I prefer. So first call, but we need to protect this variable. We need to protect it from multiple things calling it at the same time. So we need to get a acquire the lock. So we will use standard lock guard of a standard mutex. And we will do guard of our mutex, and guard is just the name of the thing. So that will ensure that we get this lock. So we are therefore, once we get to line 29, we are the only person running this bit of code. No other thread can run it. Any other thread that tries to acquire this guard whilst another thread is doing this line of code will sit and wait. This function will ensure that they sit and wait until the lock is released. And that lock is released when we go out of scope. And that's quite a nice implementation, actually, rather than give and take that FreeRTOS uses. I quite like this mechanism because, I always forget to give it again after taking it. This is scope based, so once we go out of scope, then the mutex is released, and then the next thread or CPU will come along and check this variable. Now, because we are waiting here, on the very first call, whoever gets in first will obtain this guard. Any other thread sit and wait. We will see first call is false. We will get our Mac, restart if not, in which case, who cares? But if everything's good, we then set this variable and then we jump out of scope. That's the constructor finishing. And when we go out of scope, this mutex is freed or released. and any other thread that was waiting, or CPU that was waiting here, or bearing in mind loads of things getting initialized right at the start of program execution, they then come down, have a look, see first call is set to true, and this gets skipped. And so that will go out of scope, and then same, so on and so forth, for if any other thread or task is waiting, and they'll just go through sequentially in order of who's waiting for it. So that's a crude way of doing it. Perfectly valid, not a problem with that. We can also use a FreeRTOS mutex, and I think I've just about got time to do this. So again, let me just quickly pull up my notes. In fact, no, you know what? We'll save that for the next video, because I want to show you two different ways of doing that. But these are some crude ways. Let's just quickly check that builds. I've got a feeling I've missed an include here. I think I might need to include thread. Or is Lockguard? Oh no, Lockguard might actually be in mutex. It is, yeah, Lockguard's in the mutex header, so this should compile, which it does. And everything's good. Everything works. The mutex is initialized statically, so guaranteed to be only once there. And yeah, that's all to be said about that. So in the next video, we'll do the FreeRTOS way of doing it, which may be a little bit more interesting. It's a little bit more convoluted, but I actually quite like it. I must say I'm not hugely familiar with the standard library mutexes and lockguards, and I don't particularly like that syntax there. In fact, this whole line, I just don't particularly like the look of it. But that's my preference. But the end state is, you've seen various different ways for implementing this. Thank you for your comments. As always, comments, questions, other thoughts and ideas down below in the doobly-doo. There's loads of resources out there for guarding stuff. Stack Overflow is really good for this sort of thing. But yeah, keep them coming. Hope you enjoyed, and I'll see you very soon, hopefully, for the next one.